Apple's iPhone just turned 10, and it helped change not only how we look at phones, but business and media and connectivity in huge ways. Now, since we've been covering them since the beginning, we thought we'd take a look at just how far Apple's mobile work has come in 10 years. The first iPhone hit the scene in 2007, and it was a huge gamble. Remember, back then BlackBerry, Motorola, and Nokia ruled the smartphone game, and plenty of people balked at the idea of using a touchscreen without a stylus. The OG iPhone was definitely cool, but it had a long way to go. 2008's iPhone 3G is when Apple really started to hit its stride. This was the first iPhone with Exchange Server support, meaning it could feasibly replace a BlackBerry. More importantly, the 3G introduced people to the App Store, giving birth to a whole new industry. Coincidentally, the first Android phone, the G1, launched shortly afterward and sparked a rivalry that exists to this day. The iPhone 3GS launched a year later, setting the hardware update tempo for years to come. It was a faster machine with a better camera, but it looked just like the model that came before it. 2010 was a strange year. Even before launch, the iPhone 4 made waves when our rivals obtained a prototype that was lost in a bar. Apple ditched the old curvy body in favor of a sleek glass and metal design that stuck around for a while. Features like the first Retina display made the 4 a big improvement over older models too, except for the whole antenna gate thing. Gripping the phone too tight would kill your signal. That problem was mostly fixed by the time the iPhone 4S launched in 2011. The usual hardware updates were there, but the biggest deal was Siri, the virtual assistant that came to Apple through an acquisition. In hindsight, she was pretty basic.
Here's the forecast for today.
But she was one of the first big voice interfaces, and you don't need us to tell you how big those are now. Then came the iPhone 5, which slimmed down the 4's body and brought high-speed LTE data to the iPhone. I still think this is the nicest iPhone design ever, but many complained about switching to that new Lightning port. The iPhone 5's internals would also wind up in the low-cost iPhone 5C, Apple's first attempt at a truly wallet-friendly iPhone. 2013's iPhone 5S kept the 5's look intact, but added an even better camera, global LTE support, and Touch ID. Sure, it wasn't the first fingerprint sensor we'd ever seen in a smartphone, but it was easily among the best. 2014 was a big year for Apple, literally. The iPhone 6 and 6 Plus had bigger screens than any model before them, giving the company more ammo to fight against big Android devices. That year also saw the launch of Apple Pay, and it was about time. Google had been working on mobile payments for years at that point. Needless to say, Apple's mobile competition hit an all-time high that year. The updated 6S and 6S Plus hit shelves in 2015, and though they were great phones, they didn't blow up the way the prior year's models did. They did, however, introduce the world to 3D touch, pressure-sensitive screens that gave us a whole new way to interact with our phones, even if we still forget to use it sometimes. Then, the 6S's guts soon found their way into the iPhone 5's body, giving us the curious iPhone SE in 2016. Later that year, Apple gave us the iPhone 7 and 7 Plus, and for once they broke the pattern. It still has the same design as the previous two generations. This year saw the introduction of a dual camera on the 7 Plus, which is basically everywhere now, not to mention the loss of the standard headphone jack, and we still know people who refuse to buy an iPhone because of that. And that brings us to now. Apple has come a long way, but here's hoping they pull out the big guns for the release of their 10th anniversary iPhone this fall.